Hello and welcome to another episode of Better Utah Broadcast. I'm Katie Matheson. I'm the Communications Director for Alliance for a Better Utah. And with us is Chase Thomas. Chase, what's your title?
Hey, I'm Policy and Advocacy Counsel with Alliance for a Better Utah.
All right. So every Wednesday we are going to be doing these live Facebook broadcasts. Wednesdays at 12:30. And we're going to have guests from various organizations.
Usually it's not good, just
usually won't just be us, but we are a treat, you know. So with the legislative session coming up, make sure that you check back here for legislative priorities. And make sure, so we're going to announce these videos Monday or Tuesday on our Facebook page, usually Monday, and you'll see there will be like a little video that says we're planning to go live. And what you can do is, if you want to make sure that you don't miss these videos, you can click Get Reminder so that you get reminders when we're about to go live. And if you're watching, give us a shout out. Tell us hi. Tell us what organization you're from, if you're from an organization or an activist group, just so that we know you're here. So now, Chase, today we're going to be talking about the legislative session.
Mm-hmm.
So give us the basics. When does it start? When does it end?
Yeah, so we are officially 12 days out from the legislative session starting. I'm not doing a countdown at all. So less than 2 weeks, the legislature will convene. Constitutionally, they, under the Utah Constitution, they're only allowed to meet for 45 consecutive days. That includes weekends, holidays. So they meet until about March, I think the last day is the 8th this year, midnight of March 8th.
That's a big party.
Yeah, it's always a party. Everyone gets a little tired and crazy. But, it's a long 45 days because ultimately this is the only time that the legislature can laws,
mm-hmm.
unless the governor calls them into a special session, which is usually only emergency things that have to be taken care of.
Mm-hmm.
So they have 45 days to pass all the legislation that the state needs. Hectic time, I don't get much sleep, but I like it.
Nice. Any chance you know why it's only 45 days and how does that compare to other states? Do you know?
Most states have limited legislatures,
mm-hmm.
At least they for limited time. The reasons are is that this shouldn't be a full-time position,
mm-hmm.
and so it attracts citizen legislators.
Mm-hmm.
All these people have jobs that they do in their normal life, and so they have to be able to actually do those jobs and make money for their families,
mm-hmm.
Make a career. So it just limits the ability for it to become a career.
Right. Okay. All right. So what happens? Oh, we've already kind of gone over that. What happens with the legislative session? They pass bills. Remind us, how many bills have been introduced right now? Like, how many do we know are going to be?
I don't know the exact count. I believe there's over 300 already introduced. We're supposed to have a lot more than that. I think over the course of the legislative session last year, there was over 1,000 bills.
Mm-hmm.
We're supposed to hit over 1,200 bills, I think, this year. So it's a lot of stuff to go through, especially 45 days.
Mm-hmm.
Ultimately, most of that won't be passed or even talked about. A lot of it just sits in committees or doesn't get voted on at all. Last year, I think 300 to 400 bills made it through there.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah.
So then do those bills then get brought up the next year, or is it just so people can be aware that it's a legislative priority for a legislator? Why exactly introduce all that stuff? Just hoping that it will get picked up?
Well, I mean, yeah, most of these bills are important to legislators. They're an issue that they want to resolve, and maybe it's even a constituent that has come to them and asked them to run that bill. And so they're doing their job representing their constituents. It's just that because of a limited time, they can't get to every issue that they want to address. And ultimately, some say that taking more time actually creates better legislation because they will study it more, talk about it more times, have people weigh in rather than it just being rushed through at the very end.
Right. So let's definitely come back to that, ways in which people can kind of ask their legislators to introduce some legislation that they feel was needed.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll come back to that. But for
okay.
now, what are we watching this session? What is AB watching? So policies or bills or whatever, what are we going to be looking for?
Yeah, so ABU, we don't take the traditional approach to a lot of other organizations. We're not going up there to push our own agenda or pass specific policies and bill language. We're there to go resource for the public, let people know what's happening. And then also at the same time, for bills that are already being introduced by legislators or by the groups, promoting the good policies and then trying to stave off, trying to keep the bad policies from going through. So this year we're sort of dividing up our good policies into four different categories that we're looking for. Shared prosperity, which is economic justice, healthcare things, bills that allow everyone in the state to share the prosperity that we have. The second one is all means all, which is equality. So whether it's LGBT equality, women's equality, reproductive justice, and then also criminal justice reform, making sure that all citizens of Utah have the opportunity to fully enjoy life. Third is good government. That's something that we're traditionally involved in, making sure that government is being held accountable by people, whether that's through increasing voting rights, ballot access, transparency, different things like that. And then the last one is the healthy environment. That goes to public lands, which we know is always going to be a big issue here in Utah. But then also sustainability, waste practices, different things like that. And then all the way to our water, how we get water, how we conserve it as well.
Cool. Awesome.
Lots of stuff.
Yeah, lots of stuff. And so then going back on to, let's talk about accountability and transparency.
Uh-huh.
So what does accountability and transparency look like? Those are kind of broad terms, and how are we going to make sure that that is happening on the Hill this mm-hmm. year?
Yeah, so in our state legislature, we've been dominated by one party for so long that there has that we're slowly having to build up the culture of transparency and accountability again.
Mm-hmm.
For example, the GOP House Caucus. The Senate GOP Caucus meets in secret all the time. The House GOP Caucus has become more famous for it because they do it every once in a while to go into secret and kill a bill without even receiving a vote on the floor.
Mm-hmm.
This happened with Medicaid expansion a few years ago, the Healthy Utah plan. The GOP caucus decided to have those doors that they didn't want this to happen, and so they never brought it to the floor. They had a vote in there just among Republicans. So that's something that we're always trying to bring to light to people, that this practice still continues every once in a while. And then we just look for other things that where the work of the government is not being done transparently, and we call them out for it and let people know that they need to hold their legislators accountable for it as well. On the other side, accountability, we're just always making sure that things are being done the right way. And so, I mean, there was a few years back with another person here in Lightsburg by Utah. She had this time when the Senate was going to confirm a government appointee without going through the normal process. And so she lifted up an iPad, said, "I have this press release drafted. If you guys go through with this, I'm going to hit send right now." And they didn't do it.
Mm-hmm.
So it seems like that, just making sure that we're always there, that they know we're there,
mm-hmm.
and that we're going to hold them accountable for things that they do.
Mm-hmm, yeah. It's still alarming to me every single time I hear about these closed door meetings
mm-hmm.
when they kill bills, especially for Medicaid expansion. You know, in particular, you brought that issue up. Just kind of astounding to me.
Yeah.
And so to have eyes on that, not just our eyes, but the eyes of their constituents, is, I would think, incredibly important.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and we've talked about this before, but you know, these small House districts, I mean, they're, what, like 45,000 people or something like in them?
I'm not sure.
Something like that. Your voice is that much more important for, you know, each time you contact your state legislator, it's that much more, it's that much louder because there are fewer constituents versus
mm-hmm.
our federal delegation. Cool. Okay, so then how can we be involved in the legislative session?
Yeah, so like you were saying, I mean, it's important to have people up there watching them, and that's what we do. We're up there 24/7. I barely get any sleep for the next 7 weeks. But it's important that the public get involved too. And so that's why we're there, to communicate to the public on what they can do. First, I would say stay informed. You can do this in a variety of ways. Reading the newspapers. There's online blogs that track everything, like Utah policy. You can can also use us as a resource. We don't have it up on the page yet, but at the beginning of next week, we'll have our Better Utah on the Hill page released.
Mm-hmm.
Also with that, there will be a way you can sign up for either daily, weekly, or weekly updates. And then you can also sign up for action item updates. That will let you know as soon as it happens how you can be involved on a specific issue or bill. So there's that. We're also going to have a bill tracker up there, giving our position on bills, descriptions, and then more information. So we'll be sending out an email about this. If you aren't on our email list, you should sign up so you can get that email and you know when it's live. But yes, next week we'll have Better Utah on the website. BetterUtah.org.
Great. I personally like the bill tracker. It's very simple to read. I mean, it's not out yet, but it's very kind of simple and easy to digest information. We're getting summaries of bills, is that right?
Tiny description. It's like a one-line description, so you don't have to read very much.
Mm-hmm.
And then we'll be including like news articles or different ways you can find out from where you want to.
Right. Because like you said, there's, 300 bills-ish that have been published now, so they're trying to bring to the legislature this session.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, if we get to 1,000 plus, nobody has time for lots
of
you.
Nobody
has time.
Every single
Chase
bill.
Is the only one who has time to start a single bill. So to have something like this, easy to digest, and to sift through the important, not important, but the stuff that may be more relevant to our members is
mm-hmm.
going to be very helpful. Great. So second, what can we do?
Contact your legislator. It's extremely simple, especially here in Utah, to have your voice heard on a bill. I mean, for me, I don't contact my representative and senator on the U.S. level very much because I feel like I'm just screaming at a wall.
Yeah.
Here in Utah, it's different. They actually listen, and it's easy to get in contact with them. In addition to the things we've already talked about on the website, we're going to have a spreadsheet of every legislator with their phone number, with their email address, and then also for the ones who have Twitter, we'll have that up there as well. So you can call them, you can email them, you can send them a text. We actually have some representatives who prefer getting texts rather than phone calls.
I text my legislator.
Yeah. And then also you can tweet at them. I know like Senator Wyler, he's famous on Twitter.
Famous on Twitter in Utah.
Twitter politics is awesome. Come on. I'm on Twitter all the time. But yeah, so make sure you're contacting them. And don't feel like you have to contact your legislators on every issue. I know it's very easy to get overwhelmed, to feel like you're not doing anything. So pick a few issues that you're really concerned about.
Mm-hmm.
And then contact them on those issues.
Right.
If you see something happening with either us in Action Alert, with some other group like Action Utah, or if it's an LGBT bill, all Utah will be fine following it. So just stay informed and then act on what you care about.
Right. Yeah, I gave this example last week, but I think it bears repeating. I mean, I contacted my, actually I moved recently from Riverton to Taylorsville, and when I moved, I found out who my legislators were, and I tweeted at them, Senator Karen Nain and Representative Karen Kwan, two Karens, and I tweeted at them and said, hey, you know, I'm new here, thanks, I'm your constituent now, I'm looking forward to meeting you and working with you during the session, and they were both responsive.
Mm-hmm.
And then most recently, because I have two small children, I have personal concern about gun safety and school shootings. And so I tweeted at Representative Kwan, and she responded. And so we're going to be setting up a meeting to go meet with our local school district and talk about what they're doing to make sure that the schools are safe from anything like that. So, I mean, they're very responsive.
Yes.
Yeah. which is just awesome. And especially now, as kind of cynical as this may sound, I mean, very, you know, election year.
Yeah.
I mean, they want to make sure they're responding. So.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
And then beyond just tweeting at them and sending them an email, I think it's important to know just how easily accessible they are in person as well. If you want to be what they call a citizen lobbyist, you can go up there and lobbies for your own issues. You can actually go and lobby legislators in the lobby. You go and stand outside these doors, and they have a little slip, so you write your name down and what you want to talk to them about. You send it in to your representative, and then they'll come out through the doors and talk to you.
Mm-hmm.
You can do that anytime when they're sitting on the floor. Super easy way to talk to them. can also try setting up a meeting. They might be too busy to do that, to set up a long meeting to talk with you. Mm-hmm. But if you want them to run legislation on a specific issue, that's a good way to introduce yourself, say, hey, I have this issue, I'm wondering if you can address it. Can you help me do that? Mm-hmm. So I would say, if you want to see what the legislature is like, and talk to them in person, you can do that. There's basically no security, which is concerning to me at times. there's not even a metal detector, and I feel weird walking into a huge government building like that without them. But it just shows how accessible it is.
Uh-huh. Sorry, go ahead. And
then I've talked about finding your issues, but one thing I want to say is, if there's big group actions, make sure to show up as well. There's lots of rallies that happen. There's different theme days, like nonprofit day or religion day. I can't remember what they're called actually. But
they have an arts day too.
Yeah, they have an arts day on the Hill. All these different things. So if you have a family member, community member, a friend, or you're part of a group and they're going to do some type of action, make sure to show up as well, even if it's not your core issue, just because it's a huge message when there's a huge crowd up there in the Capitol on an issue. Like
sure.
Women's Day last year.
Yeah.
That was amazing. So those are all my tips.
Very cool. Now, to clarify, if somebody wants to become a citizen lobbyist, how does that work? They just walk up and write their name on a piece of paper and it gets sent in? They don't have to be... And you don't have to have any kind of paperwork or anything like
nope,
that?
Nope, you do not have to register as a citizen lobbyist. Lobbyists, I am technically a registered lobbyist because I get paid to go up and talk to legislators.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like I'm trying to make someone some money. We're a nonprofit and just trying to make a better Utah. But I had to register as a lobbyist because I'm being paid to do it.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're not getting paid to do it, you're just going out there because you say, hey, I'm really concerned about what you're doing with taxes.
Mm-hmm.
You can go up there and just sign a slip outside the big doors of the House or the Senate, send it in, and they'll come and talk to you.
Nice. I went up to the legislature last session when I still lived in Riverton, and I was able to get a meeting with my legislator, my representative, Representative Notwell, and we talked about gerrymandering.
Mm-hmm.
And I was concerned about gerrymandering, so we talked about the Supreme Court case that's going on right now, Bill v. Whitford, and he was great, and he was open, and he listened, and then he allowed me to come and sit actually next to him on the
awesome.
Floor during the session. Yeah,
that's
it was
cool.
Really cool, and he kind of explained the whole process, what was going on, and it was just a great experience, and then to walk up through those doors and
mm-hmm.
see everybody waiting to speak with their legislator was really cool.
Yeah,
you've
experienced where the word lobbies come from.
Mm-hmm.
Just there are people standing in the lobby wanting to talk to their legislator.
All right, so to wrap up, if you have any questions about the legislative session, what exactly being a lobbyist looks like, a civilian lobbyist looks like, or a citizen lobbyist rather, feel free to reach out to us. You can tweet at us, contact us on Facebook, you can email us, and we're also on Instagram.
Write
so
in the comments as well.
Write in the comments as well, that's right. And this is we're all at Better Utah. And also let us know how you're committing to be more civically engaged this session and this year in general, because it is the midterm election year, so a very important year for everyone to get involved. And you can, like Chase said, subscribe to our email updates. Chase can be writing daily updates because that's how intense Chase is.
I actually love the legislative sessions. And I feel really nerdy saying that. It's exhausting, but I love legislative process.
That's okay. And then remember, we have the Escape the Inversion contest that's going on. Deadline to apply to enter into the Escape the Inversion contest is this Friday, so it's the 12th at midnight. And so the winner of that contest will get a 7-night stay at the Marriott Grand Chateau in Las Vegas.
Woo!
So you get to escape the inversion, hence the name. And then tomorrow, so that's Thursday, 12 to 1, we are going to be at the Food Truck Thursday at the Gallivan Center, and we're going to have 5 ballot initiatives.
We have 4.
We're going to have 4.
So we have all the ones except for Count My Vote. We're never able to get a packet. So we have all the other ones from marijuana, school funding, redistricting, and Medicaid expansion.
All right. So you can come, eat, and sign tomorrow with us, or just if you've already signed all of them, which I'm sure many of you already have, just come and say hi.
Yeah, just look for the tall guy.
and the tall woman. Yes,
oh, yeah,
well.
You're pretty tall, too.
Yeah, and then Laura. So we'll be there passing out, you know, forms for people to sign.
Yep.
And then next Wednesday evening here at the Impact Hub and also here on Facebook Live, we're going to have a panel about education funding.
Mm-hmm.
Thrilling topic. Very important topic. So stay tuned for more information about that. Remember to join us every Wednesday, 12:30, for these interviews, and click or get reminder to get reminders when we go live. Next Wednesday, we'll be meeting with Better Boundaries, and they're the ones heading up the fairy districting gerrymandering ballot initiative. All right, so we will see you next week.